Hello. It is with great excitement we welcome you to the Northwestern Medicine Parkinson's Summer Seminar Series. The Northwestern Medicine Parkinson's Disease and Movement Disorder Centers provide innovative, multidisciplinary care for patients and families affected by Parkinson's disease and other movement disorders. The center's care team works to promote health, education, and support for patients, care partners, and family members. We achieve this through a patient-centered approach to the management of Parkinson's disease that includes rehabilitation, wellness, and support services in the comfort of your community. You may find comprehensive movement disorder care at three Northwestern Medicine hospitals, including Northwestern Memorial Hospital, Northwestern Medicine Central DuPage Hospital, and Northwestern Medicine Lake Forest Hospital. Thank you for joining us and our distinguished panel of speakers. We hope this seminar series provides an opportunity for education, inspiration, and motivation.
Hello, my name is Susan Chaffness, and my husband, Al, has had Parkinson's for more than 20 years. Over the years, we have been involved in numerous clinical trials, treatment plans, regular exercise classes, and monthly support group meetings at Lake Forest Hospital. As a Parkinson's caregiver, I have found that diet and Parkinson's can affect each other. What to eat and when to eat can become confusing and overwhelming. I am reminded of a quote by Virginia Woolf that says, "One cannot think well, love well, sleep well if one has not dined well." Whether you are making a meal at home or dining out with family or friends, food choices impact how we feel and function. Our next speaker, Dr. Martha McGraw, is a movement disorder specialist at Northwestern Medicine Central DuPage Hospital. She will help us navigate our way through the ins and outs of nutrition and Parkinson's disease. Now I am pleased to introduce Dr. Martha McGraw.
Hello, I am Martha McGraw. I'm the physician lead for movement disorders at Northwestern Medicine Central DuPage Hospital, and I'm here today to talk a little bit about nutrition and Parkinson's disease. I have no disclosures related to today's program, but I do admit a partiality to fresh bread, peaches, and homegrown tomatoes. So how important is diet? You know, diet is really complicated. I really wish that I could say it was as simple as a cartoon like this one. So if you were all here today, I'd say how many people remember Saturday morning cartoons? But I do from my childhood, and I liked Popeye. I wish it was as simple as this. Popeye is having a bad day on the left-hand side of the screen there. And then with the administration of some fresh green leafy vegetables, or canned spinach in this case, and the help of his care partner, heart-healthy olive oil, our champ is back in fighting action again. But unfortunately, of course, it's not that simple. It's not as simple as a cartoon. And diet is very complicated, and how it interacts with our bodies, and especially a disease state like Parkinson's disease, is complex. But here's what we'll talk about today. I'm going to give a very brief overview of Parkinson's disease and talk a little bit about the gut-brain connection, how Parkinson's, people with Parkinson's how there's a relationship between the intestines and the gut and the brain. We'll talk about diet and Parkinson's, touch on supplements, and how food interacts with medications, and then we'll have summarize with some recommendations. So if you're listening to this, you probably know what Parkinson's disease is. It is a progressive chronic neurodegenerative disease. It's characterized by the loss of dopamine-producing neurons in the substantia nigra, a deep part of the brain. You can see it in the diagram there. And it leads to difficulty with voluntary movement. It is a clinical diagnosis, and it's based on four classic findings: tremor, bradykinesia, or slow movement, rigidity, and gait and balance changes. Even though we talk about Parkinson's as a movement disorder, we know that it's actually much more complex than that, and the motor symptoms, tremor and whatnot, are really just the tip of the iceberg. The non-motor symptoms, things like hypotension, low blood pressure, anxiety, depression, sleep changes, represent a much larger picture that is sort of under the surface, but can affect patients just as much, if not more, than the motor symptoms. All right, next we're going to do a little glossary or definition review here. And that's just so that we're all on the same page, and you'll know some of the terms that I talk about later in the talk. So Parkinson's disease, we already talked about that. We all know what that is. You may hear the term neuroprotection. And that means we're talking about protecting brain cells and reducing neurodegeneration. So slowing the loss of brain cells, or maybe preventing their loss. So we talk a lot about risk reduction, reducing the chance of developing Parkinson's. Then once people have disease, we talk about disease modification. And this means a process that acts on the underlying mechanism of the disease to stop, slow, or reverse progression. So that's once you already have disease. We also talk about symptom management. And this is treatment of symptoms, but regardless of any effect on the actual underlying disease process. Because we measure Parkinson's progression by clinical assessment of symptoms, it's often difficult to know if treatment is actually affecting the underlying disease. So a few more things. We're getting a little back to basic science here. Alpha-synuclein, you may have heard of that. It is a protein that is misfolded in Parkinson's disease and leads to cell death. So everybody has alpha-synuclein in the brain, but people with Parkinson's have an abnormally folded form of the protein that contributes to disease. Lewy bodies, and I have a picture on the right there of a Lewy body. It's that sort of halo pink circle in the middle of the slide. Lewy bodies are the pathologic hallmark of Parkinson's disease, and they contain alpha-synuclein. You're also going to hear me talk about the enteric nervous system, or the enteric plexus, and this is the network of nerves lining the gut. So it's the part of the nervous system that is directly connected to the gut. And finally, the gut microbiome. This is the bacterial population of your gut. So our intestines are all filled with bacteria, and the makeup of that bacterial population varies. So let's move on and talk a little bit more about the gut-brain connection. Dr. James Parkinson's first described GI dysfunction in Parkinson's back in his original paper in 1817. So from the very beginning, when this disease was first defined, it was recognized that it affected the gut. Unfortunately, we didn't focus on that for a long time, and then over the past decade or so, it's come into the spotlight again as we focus more on non-motor features. But it was recognized well over 100 years ago. 70 to 80% of people with Parkinson's do have GI issues. Constipation is certainly the most common, and that can actually predate other symptoms by over 10 years. It's a common complaint in the general population, so just because you have constipation doesn't mean you have early Parkinson's. But once you have a diagnosis of Parkinson's, we can look back and often see that the constipation was maybe one of the earliest signs. Other GI symptoms include slow stomach emptying, bloating, drooling, trouble swallowing, and trouble with defecation. So Parkinson's can really affect the entire pathway of the GI system. Starting with the salivary glands, people with Parkinson's actually have decreased production of saliva, which may sound strange because a lot of people complain of drooling, but that's because they're not swallowing their saliva very well. But there actually is overall decreased production of saliva, and it's a little thicker. Some people will notice a dry mouth. The mouth itself and chewing can be affected by Parkinson's. Rigidity can make it more difficult to chew. Dystonia can cause teeth grinding and actually damage the teeth. The esophagus, the tube that carries food from the mouth down to the stomach, can be affected by Parkinson's, and the muscular contractions don't work as well. It makes it harder to swallow and can cause some esophageal spasm. The stomach itself is certainly affected. There's slowed gastric emptying, so when you take food or you take medications, these may sit in your stomach for a while. The stomach doesn't empty into the intestines as quickly as it should. And that can lead to early satiety. It can cause nausea. It can cause decreased food intake, some weight loss. It can delay the effect of medications because they're not getting delivered to the intestine. They're just sitting there in the stomach. The small intestines themselves are also slowed. That can lead to some abdominal distension, and it can also affect the gut microbiome. It can cause bacterial overgrowth, malabsorption, weight loss. Moving through the system down to the large intestines, again, we see slow transit. That leads to constipation, more abdominal distension. And finally, Parkinson's also affects the rectum and can cause defecatory dysfunction. And that just means that the muscles that have to work together to expel stool don't work properly. It makes it harder to have a bowel movement. And the pathology supports this as well. So I'm not going to go over this whole slide, but basically just shows you that those Lewy bodies that we talked about earlier, the pathologic hallmark of Parkinson's, are found not only in the brain and in the substantia nigra, but throughout the nervous system that lines the gut and controls the gut. So we know we've got alpha-synuclein pathology in the gut, in the nervous system around the gut. We know it's in the brain. Could there be a connection between these two things? So there is a theory, and I should say this is a theory, this is not definitive, but that the GI tract could be the entry point or the beginning of Parkinson's disease. Perhaps there's a pathogen or an environmental toxin that triggers alpha-synuclein pathology or misfolding of alpha-synuclein in the enteric nervous system in the gut, and then that spreads through the vagus nerve up to the brain. What could trigger that? Well, we don't really know. It could be environmental toxins, could be diet, maybe intestinal microorganisms. We don't know. But again, this is one theory about how Parkinson's may start and why the gut is one of the earliest areas affected. Some other things that kind of are interesting about that gut-brain connection, like I said, Lewy body pathology is present in the gut years before diagnosis. In patients who have had vagus nerve lesions, if they've had their vagus nerve cut for some reason, they tend to have a decreased risk of Parkinson's disease. It suggests that maybe cutting the vagus nerve interrupts that pathway. Also, patients who've had their appendix removed, if you've had an appendectomy, that is associated with a decreased risk and later onset of Parkinson's disease. There are several studies that show that the microbiome, the bacterial makeup of the gut, is different in Parkinson's related to normal controls. And we don't know why. That could be due to constipation, it could be due to malabsorption, it could be due to diet, it could be due to medications, or Parkinson's itself. We don't know. But this all really leads to the question, can therapies targeting the gut or the microbiome of the gut help prevent or slow Parkinson's disease? What about diet? How does diet play into this? Now, unfortunately, data is not consistent. You know, research has not been definitive at all, and more research is needed. But these are very interesting questions, and we'll talk a little bit about them today as we talk about diet and Parkinson's. So, diet and Parkinson's. It's a blank slide, right? There's so much out there. There's so much information coming in about diet and Parkinson's. Patients are always bringing me little clippings from the newspaper that says, oh, look, coffee reduces chances of Parkinson's disease, or a little reference to an article off the internet that shows, you know, that acacia berries reduce Parkinson's disease, or this or that. There's all this incoming information. Some of it's contradictory. What do you make of it? You know, what's the best diet for Parkinson's? Should it be a low-fat diet? What about low cholesterol? Eggs, oh my gosh. So for years, eggs were bad. Don't eat eggs, right? And then suddenly, oh, eggs are great. We should all be eating eggs in our diet. Then another one that says, oh, maybe not. And the information is very conflicting. What about low-carb diet? Gluten-free, that's been very popular lately. Probiotics, are they worthwhile? Are they helpful? Green tea, coconut oil, spinach, there's Popeye again. Milk, dairy, what about that? Acacia berries, coffee, kale, berries, vegetables. It's kind of overwhelming. So what's the right answer? We'll try to explore a little bit some of these questions today. But I think this cartoon kind of summarizes it well. Good news, your diet, weight, and cholesterol stayed the same, but the research findings have changed. That's certainly the case with diet and Parkinson's disease. So why? Why do we have conflicting data? Why do we not have better answers? Really, it's just that dietary research is fraught with obstacles. Most dietary research is based on questionnaires, and these are prone to recall bias. So again, I would say, who remembers what they had for breakfast this morning? Probably most of us, right? What about breakfast 2 days ago? What about breakfast 2 weeks ago? Unless you eat the same thing every day, which you may, you probably don't remember. So it's very difficult to get reliable research data based on recall. Also, single foods are complex. Each food, you know, contains multiple different nutrients that are also shared with other foods. So if, you know, berries are good for Parkinson's disease, what is it in the berries that makes it good? Is that also in some other food? How do you sort that out? That's difficult. Most study groups tend to involve people that tend to have kind of similar lifestyles and diets. Maybe they live in the same area or in the same economic class, so it's difficult to get a real diverse sample. Dietary assessments tend to be short-term, so you can keep track of diet for 6 weeks, maybe even 12 weeks, maybe even 6 months, but not really beyond that. And dietary effects are likely much more long-term. So something that takes years to have an effect on your brain and your body can only be studied for a few weeks. It's difficult. Evidence is often very conflicting, and dietary factors that reduce risk of one disease may increase risk of another disease. So that's complicating. Lots of problems. But so let's look at what we know about Parkinson's. So there are dietary factors that may increase the risk of Parkinson's disease. And probably the one we know most about is dairy. So dairy products may lower urate. Urate is an antioxidant that may be protective. Antioxidants basically kind of scavenge free radicals and toxins and help protect cells. So why is dairy bad? So it may lower this protective urate. Dairy may be contaminated with pesticides, depending on the source. And the risk with dairy seems to be more associated with milk than with other dairy foods. Also, it seems to affect men more than women. So again, not fully understood, but there may be a role there. Fat and carbohydrates, they may also play a role. We know that people who are overweight in midlife have a higher risk of Parkinson's later in life. But again, the full story is not understood. What about risk reduction? Now, these are things you may have heard about. These are the kinds of things that make the news, I think. So caffeine. Caffeine may be neuroprotective. Could it be? We don't know. It works as an antagonist at the adenosine A2 receptors in the brain. There have been two U.S. studies that showed a lower risk of Parkinson's disease in people who had a high caffeine or coffee intake, about 5 cups a day. So this is just not your standard 1 to 2 cups, but in people who drank 5 cups a day, they had a reduced risk of Parkinson's disease. The benefit seems to be due to the caffeine component. In a large meta-analysis, they seem to be about 30% a lower risk of Parkinson's in coffee drinkers, 25% lower in other caffeine consumers, so somebody who's drinking tea all day, or heaven forbid, Mountain Dew. But coffee's been where most of the data has come from, and there may be some benefit there. Even though caffeine may be associated with a decreased risk of developing Parkinson's, there's no clear evidence that it's helpful in actually treating or slowing the progression of established disease. And they actually did a study, a 6-month study, showed no motor benefit to it, with a daily dose of 400 milligrams caffeine. Nicotine. Well, we're sounding great here. Caffeine, nicotine, you know, these aren't sounding like our usual lifestyle recommendations, right? Well, let's talk about nicotine. So a lot of this comes from data that shows people who smoke have a lower risk of Parkinson's disease. We know that dopamine metabolism in the brain produces free radicals, and these are toxins that are damaging to brain cells. And nicotine scavenges or eats up some of those free radicals. Like I said, the risk of Parkinson's is lower in smokers, and it's related to the duration of smoking, not the amount. So the longer you smoke, the lower the risk of Parkinson's disease. Again, that's just counterintuitive to everything we hear in health and medicine. And as a physician, it's even kind of hard to say that, right? But the reason I pointed out is this makes smoking really hard to study, because we're not going to say, okay, you smoke for 5 years and you don't smoke for 5 years, and let's see what happens with your Parkinson's, right? Certainly not going to do that. Nicotine is associated with decreased risk, but no evidence that it is actually helpful in slowing progression of established disease. And again, there was a 28-week study that showed no motor benefit to transdermal nicotine. That was a nicotine patch. So at least that way they could get the nicotine without the cigarettes. So let me just emphasize again, overall, the health risks of smoking far outweigh any potential benefits. But, bonus, plants in the Solanaceae family contain nicotine. These are peppers. Tomatoes, those homegrown tomatoes that are just coming ripe this time of year. Potatoes, eggplant. And at least one study has shown a decreased risk of Parkinson's with high consumption of these foods. So if you want to try nicotine, go for these veggies. These are also foods that are featured in the Mediterranean diet, which we'll talk about in a little later. So, yes, tobacco counts as a leafy vegetable, but only if you eat it in a salad. For the record, tobacco leaves are poisonous. They give you a rash and make you sick, so don't eat them. So other factors that may reduce risk, antioxidants. So you hear that term thrown around a lot. Oh, take this supplement, it's an antioxidant. Eat blueberries, they have antioxidants. You know, antioxidants is a broad term, and it really refers to molecules that reduce oxidative stress. So cellular processes, just the process of staying alive for a cell, creates what we call oxidative stress and free radicals. These contribute to the degeneration of neurons. Dietary antioxidants and anti-inflammatory molecules may help reduce that oxidative stress and reduce those free radicals. And like I said, there's hundreds of substances that act as antioxidants. Urate that I mentioned earlier, flavonoids, which are present in colorful fruits and vegetables, polyphenols, that's present in black tea, green tea. And it's hard to isolate these things because there's a lot of overlap. They're in multiple different foods. They're part of a complex diet. In general, though, several studies suggest that a diet high in fruits and vegetables, legumes, whole grains, poultry, and fish are associated with a lower risk of Parkinson's. So the take-home message here about antioxidants, I would say, is that a healthy diet is more beneficial than any single dietary component. So you don't need to eat blueberries all day long. You need to eat a nice, healthy, balanced diet. So a few more words about different antioxidants. Inosine, this is an antioxidant that raises urate levels. And there was a large trial looking at inosine to see if it would reduce or slow the progression of Parkinson's disease. But unfortunately, the trial was not effective and actually was stopped early because of lack of efficacy. Vitamin E is one that comes up over time. This is an antioxidant that works on cell membranes. There was a study looking at 2,000 units a day in 800 newly diagnosed Parkinson's patients, and there was no benefit seen in delaying disability or delaying the need for levodopa. Coenzyme Q10, this one's gotten a lot of press over the years. We've been back and forth on coenzyme Q10. So it's an antioxidant that supports mitochondrial function in the cell. And many years ago, there was a phase 2 trial that showed some potential benefit. I actually even used to recommend this for my patients. But a subsequent phase 3 trial in over 600 patients, lasted over a year, showed no benefit at either 1,200 or 2,400 milligrams, so pretty high doses. And then there was another additional follow-up study that, again, was stopped due to lack of efficacy. And I should mention, the doses that we're looking at to have any benefit in coenzyme Q10 are pretty high. So there's not a lot of benefit to just taking 200 milligrams. You really need, you know, if it were going to have any benefit, it needs to be up in that 1,200 milligram range, which gets kind of pricey. So I don't recommend this anymore because I don't want to recommend something that costs a lot of money that hasn't actually been shown to have any benefit. But certainly I have patients who take it. Creatine. Creatine is involved in cellular energy production. There was some possible benefit in an early trial, but larger phase 3 trial of almost 2,000 patients over 5 years did not show any benefit. So unfortunately, these agents have not been shown to be beneficial when used regularly in Parkinson's disease. So what about diet? So there was a large observational study of over 1,000 patients with Parkinson's, and they looked at 33 common Parkinson's symptoms, and they looked at what these people were eating and kind of put them into groups of the foods that were associated with reduced rate of decline, slower disease, versus the dietary choices that seemed to be associated with more rapid progression. And this probably won't surprise anybody. On the good side, slower progression was associated with fresh fruits and vegetables, nuts and seeds, non-fried fish, so no fish and chips, olive oil, wine, coconut oil, fresh herbs and spices. And the patients who progressed more rapidly, those signs were associated with canned and processed fruits and vegetables, diet and non-diet sodas, fried foods, beef, ice cream, yogurt, and cheese. So once again, Popeye wins. Take-home message, avoid processed foods. What about a Mediterranean diet? We hear about that one a lot. There have actually been several studies in Parkinson's disease that have shown a benefit with the Mediterranean diet. This diet really involves a high intake of plant foods, some fish, moderate wine. And these foods contain components that have antioxidants and anti-inflammatory effects or properties. This diet promotes a favorable gut bacteria, so back to that gut microbiome we talked about. And this diet's been shown to improve non-motor symptoms in Parkinson's and in prodromal Parkinson's, so people who haven't even been diagnosed yet. It improves sleep, depression, and daytime somnolence. And these are common things that we deal with in Parkinson's. So you know, even if we can't help the underlying disease, if we can help these symptoms, that can have a big impact on people's lives. People on these types of diets had a lower risk of developing Parkinson's. And if they did develop Parkinson's, they tended to develop it at a later age. We're going to take it one step further and talk about the MIND diet. What is the MIND diet? Well, this stands for Mediterranean Dash Intervention for Neurodegenerative Delay. But we don't want to say that all the time, so we just say MIND diet. What's on the MIND diet? Basically, it's a Mediterranean diet with some extra berries and nuts. That's the way I summarize it. But it includes 3 servings of whole grains daily, at least 1 dark green salad and 1 other vegetable every day, berries at least twice a week, 1 ounce serving of nuts every day, beans or legumes, poultry, fish, and then no more than 1 tablespoon of butter or margarine. Choose olive oil instead. And also you should limit, of course, cheese, fast food, fried food, things like that. On the other hand, it's not a real restrictive diet. You get to have wine, you get to have dessert 5 times a week. You know, it's doable. It's a doable diet. I think that's important to emphasize because so many diets out there are pretty restrictive. But this one is actually not. You know, it really fits into a healthy lifestyle. And it makes sense. You know, it's intuitive that these things are good for us. We learned this in kindergarten, right? So supplements, these are questions I get a lot. What about supplements? If dietary research is difficult, supplements are perhaps even more so. There is very little human data on supplements and micronutrients, and it's very mixed. One study may support the use of supplements, another may negate it, but perhaps the biggest problem is that they're not really based on humans. Many of the recommendations about supplements that you'll read on the internet or on health food sites are based on in vitro observations. So they're based on what's seen in a petri dish, based on the theoretical properties of these supplements. Sometimes they're based on rodent models. But there's a really, really big gap between a mice and a man or woman. There's really a really big difference between a chimpanzee and a human. And so what works in a mice or even a chimpanzee, for the large part, doesn't always apply to humans. But, again, bonus here, most of these biomolecules that have shown some kind of benefit in animal models are well represented in the MIND diet. So if you're doing the MIND diet, you're going to be getting really all the supplements that may have some potential benefit. So recommendations. There are a few recommendations I do give my patients. So people with Parkinson's are more likely to have low vitamin D levels, and that can lead to bone loss as well as cognitive decline. It's kind of hard to get enough vitamin D through diet and sun exposure, especially in Chicago where it's cold 6 months of the year. And so many people do need a vitamin D supplement. So if you have Parkinson's disease, you should have your vitamin D levels checked. And if they're low, we want to supplement that. We like to keep vitamin D levels a little higher than just the bare minimum. So I like to keep them over 40 in my patients. So vitamin D should be replaced if deficient. Same thing for vitamin B12. You don't need super high levels of vitamin B12, but you do want to keep your levels at a robust level. I want them over 400 in my patients. And that is somewhat preventative. It helps prevent cognitive decline and, let me rephrase that, I'm sorry, low B12 can contribute to cognitive decline, neuropathy, other neurologic problems. So we don't want to get into that deficient zone. But if you have enough, you have enough. You don't need more. There are 3 supplements that do have some human data behind them. And these are alpha-lipoic acid, N-acetylcysteine, and omega-3 fatty acids. These are in flaxseed and salmon. So those are the 3 supplements that I think have a little bit more human data to back them up. Still not something I say everybody should be on, but if you really are looking for a supplement and I want to do every single thing I can do to possibly help my Parkinson's, I think these have a little more data behind them than most of the supplements out there. So we can't talk about diet and Parkinson's without giving some attention to constipation. 70 to 80% of patients with Parkinson's do experience constipation, and they may not feel uncomfortable. I mean, I have patients who come in and tell me, I have a bowel movement every 4 or 5 days, but I feel fine. And other people may say, oh my gosh, 4 or 5 days, that sounds miserable. But it just depends. People have different perceptions of comfort, and Parkinson's can change your awareness of how your body feels. So even if you don't feel uncomfortable when you're constipated, we still want to treat that, because constipation affects other things too. It affects cognition, it affects gait, it causes fatigue, and it can limit the effect of your medications. Down the road, it can cause even more serious complications: hemorrhoids, anal fissures, rectal prolapse, fecal impaction, diarrhea. You end up in the ER, you end up in the hospital, you don't want to go there. So we want to stay ahead of constipation, even if it's not uncomfortable. Number one thing in treating constipation, water. I'm sure you've all heard it. We recommend a minimum of 48 to 64 ounces daily. We also want to increase dietary fiber. Look for foods with 3 to 5 grams of fiber per serving. Things like whole grains, bran, fruits and vegetables. And the other big thing is exercise. Moving your muscles, moving your body helps move your bowels. We sometimes recommend the Rancho recipe. It's sort of a homemade concoction, high fiber concoction that can help people with their bowels. I have it listed on the slide. You can look at that. And then I also just recommend that people think about ways to incorporate water into their diet. As we get older, we lose our thirst reflex. So you don't necessarily feel thirsty, even if you're a little dehydrated. So a lot of older people kind of walk around in a state of mild dehydration, and that certainly aggravates constipation. So you have to think, how am I going to get my water in? So some people like to fill up a big jug and make sure they drink the whole thing by the end of the day. And these are some fun ones that give you some little encouragement along the way. You know, by 3 p.m. you should have drinking half the bottle, and they tell you keep drinking. Other people don't want to carry around a water bottle. So for them, I say, make sure you drink 12 ounces in the morning when you first get up, and then 12 ounces with every dose of medication, or perhaps with every meal. And that's one way to get to that 48 ounces. But the key is really just to be thinking about it and be deliberate about it. What about the interaction between food and Parkinson's medications? This is a question that comes up a lot. Protein interferes with the absorption of levodopa. And in my slide here, you can see on the left-hand side are all the things inside the intestines. Levodopa, protein, food, things like that. The gray blocks are the intestinal wall, and then on the right is the bloodstream. That's where we want the levodopa to get. But proteins are absorbed from the intestines through the wall of the gut by transporter molecules, transporter proteins. And those transporters transport all protein, whether it's food or whether it's levodopa, because levodopa is a protein. So if you have a lot of protein in your gut, you just had a big steak dinner, then all those receptors are being used to absorb that steak dinner, and there's less availability to absorb the levodopa. So protein slows the absorption of levodopa. Because of that, we'll often say, try to take your medicines 30 to 60 minutes before a meal or 60 minutes after a meal. Try eating several small meals throughout the day instead of three big meals. Limit protein earlier in the day so that your medicines can get absorbed, and then have a larger protein intake later in the day when maybe you're not as active or not doing stuff. But you want to make sure you do get enough protein. You don't want to limit protein. You need that to maintain muscle mass and strength. We don't want you to avoid it. We just want you to spread it out. Also, taking medications with sparkling water can help their absorption. And you want to just make sure you are getting a good, nutritious diet. Now, that can be hard, all those things I just said. I mean, if you're taking medicines, let's say, 6 times a day, how are you going to keep it 30 minutes before a meal or 60 minutes after a meal? I mean, it's pretty daunting. And we don't want people to stop eating because they're trying to get their meds in. It's just difficult. And I will say that this protein interaction affects different people differently. I have plenty of patients who can take their medicines with a steak dinner and they work just fine, not a problem. I have other patients, any amount of protein really tends to affect their medications. So I advise you, talk to your doctor about how big of an impact protein may have on your particular case, and make sure you are getting enough nutrition. A couple other obstacles. It may be hard to eat if your medicines aren't working. You may not really like the diets that are recommended. people with Parkinson's have a change in their sense of smell, so food may not taste as good. There are changes in brain metabolism. Depression affects appetite. It may just take you longer to eat, and you get tired of eating. So all those things can just make it difficult. So I'm going to end with some recommendations. We'll start with what to eat. follow the MIND diet. Fruits and vegetables, especially leafy greens and berries, whole grains, beans, nuts and seeds, spices, choose colorful foods, and then avoid processed and refined sugary foods. Manage constipation, maintain fiber in your diet, plenty of water, and maintain a healthy weight. Watch the nutritional content of your food. Add calorie supplements if needed. Ensure boost, things like that. A lot of times people with Parkinson's tend to be drawn to sweets. You want to make sure your whole day does not consist of ice cream. So you want to balance the diet out. When to eat. If you can manage it, if maybe you only take medicines 3 times a day and you have a pretty regular schedule and you can take your medicines on an empty stomach without any problems, then take them 30 minutes before a meal or 60 minutes after a meal, and that will improve absorption of your medicines. Eat smaller, more frequent meals. But for some people, medications can be nauseating. If they take them 30 minutes before they eat, it will make them even throw up. So in those cases, it may be better to take your medicines with meals because that will minimize the GI side effects. So again, it goes back to just making sure you're making a good choice for your personal situation and discussing that with your doctor. Parkinson's is not one size fits all. Everybody is different. Because of delayed gastric emptying, patients may take medications. The medications can sit in the stomach for quite a while before getting delivered to the intestines, so then they don't work. The patient says, I took my pill an hour ago and it still hasn't kicked in. So sometimes taking medications with sparkling water can help with this. Sometimes actually eating or drinking some coffee can trigger the stomach to empty and then the medicines can be absorbed. So again, all these things come into play. You have to balance the timing of your meals with the quality of life. And that's the take-home message. Again, there's not one size fits all. Balance the timing of meals with the quality of your life. Don't make yourself miserable to try to take meds 30 minutes before every meal all day long. So how do we do this? Some of these changes may seem kind of overwhelming. Some people may say, oh, I already do all those things. Great. But if you're trying to change your habits to a more healthy lifestyle to support your Parkinson's, I suggest you do it one step at a time. You don't have to change everything at once. Do what you can. Most people are more successful if they make minor changes gradually over time rather than doing a total overhaul of their lifestyle. Also, this is important. Any change is good. So you may not get over to a complete MIND diet or Mediterranean diet, but any step in the right direction is worthwhile. And studies have shown that people who partially followed the MIND diet or a Mediterranean-style diet also showed benefit. Obviously, you get the most benefit if you really commit to these diets, but you get some benefit even just with a partial adjustment of your diet in this direction. So I think that's important to point out. It's not all or nothing. Any change in the right direction is good. Supplements. My advice is don't spend a lot of money on supplements. Spend it on fresh, healthy food and maybe a gym membership. Well, not these days in COVID, but focus on the exercise and a healthy diet. And I think you're going to get a lot more bang for your buck and a lot more benefit than, you know, additional capsules every morning. And then, of course, we can't talk about Parkinson's without mentioning exercise. It's crucial. Brings us back to Popeye. Here's Popeye on the MIND diet. He's eating his spinach. He's got his Greek outfit on. And hopefully with these types of changes, you know, we can fight back against Parkinson's disease. Thank you very much for listening, and I hope you learned something. I think we have a couple of questions that we received from people sending those in. Thank you for doing that. So one question was, what about supplements? Are they worth taking? And hopefully I've addressed that in the talk. There are a few that have a little bit of data to support their use. The N-acetylcysteine, alpha-lipoic acid. You're going to make sure your vitamin D and B12 levels are good. But if they are good, you don't need to take extra. Again, I would direct your resources towards focusing on the diet and the exercise rather than additional supplements. And the other question is, are there ways to predict if you're going to develop dementia with Parkinson's? And is there a point at which you are safe from that? You've gotten to a point where, oh, if you haven't developed dementia by now, you're not going to. So I would say, unfortunately, we don't have a crystal ball, and there are no check boxes that we can say, at this point, you will never get dementia. Even people without Parkinson's get dementia. So there's no way for us to say someone has gotten to a point where that's never going to be a problem for them. Unfortunately, there's also no way for us to predict earlier in disease if that will be a problem down the road. There are certain factors, certain characteristics of disease that tend to be more associated with a higher risk of developing cognitive changes and dementia down the road. And we can look at the overall picture and the overall nature and characteristics of one person's disease, and that may indicate, they may be at higher risk for dementia down the road or less risk. But again, this is not definitive, and that's something you should talk about individually with your doctor. So there's no definitive way to predict that. But I think that's on a lot of people's minds. Appreciate the question. I will say that all the things I talked about today about diet and Parkinson's disease also apply to cognition. Maybe that's why I got this question. These studies and this data overlaps a lot with the dietary research done in Alzheimer's disease and dementia. So if you're looking to prevent dementia, I'm going to tell you the same things that I tell you about Parkinson's disease with when it comes to diet. Try to stick to the mind diet, try to get regular exercise, and that's going to protect you really against both as much as anything can. So that's all I have. Thank you very much.
Thank you for attending the Northwestern Medicine Parkinson's Summer Seminar Series hosted by Lake Forest Hospital. The Parkinson's program at Lake Forest Hospital offers weekly exercise classes, a monthly support group, and activities including horseback riding and improv classes. In addition, we are proud to now offer access to clinical research trials through Northwestern Medicine. The Parkinson's program at Lake Forest Hospital is completely donor-funded. Generous donations from individual community members support all of the programs and enable the program to expand. For more information about the Parkinson's program at Lake Forest Hospital, please contact Linda Egan, Parkinson's Program Coordinator, at 847-535-8244 or legan@nm.org.